Ender's Game, this has been in some kind of development. People have been talking about making this into a film for 20 years odd. Mm. I mean, what came together to make now the right time?
People have been wanting to make the film for a very, very long time. I think what came together was that two things, I guess. Visual effects have reached a point where we really can render these fabulous scenes in the battle room and in the simulation cave in a photorealistic way that's really worthy of the ideas in the book, that this battle room could be really beautifully put together with a combination of physical effects with our young actors on wires, and they were trained by Cirque du Soleil performers and amazing stunt department, so that they could do these physical movements for their closer work. But when you get these big wide shots, of course you're in this entirely virtual environment, which I believe is incredible work from Matthew Butler, the visual effects supervisor, and his team. That level of photorealism wasn't possible perhaps 20 years ago. But the other thing is that I think I was just very lucky that I didn't know what a struggle different writers had working for the studio in trying to adapt it. And I just came to it rather naively. I was sent the book by my agent. Gigi Pritzker was looking for writers. I went for a job interview with others, I'm sure. And luckily they liked the way I pitched it. And I think my approach was fairly simple, really. I just felt that we needed, obviously the book is very long, and I felt we needed to be true to the themes and ideas at its heart, and that I would have to compress time in order to put it into 2 hours, and that I would stick with the character of Ender Wiggin in every single scene, because in order to get to know him as this complex kid, he isn't just a good guy fighting bad guys, he's a complex kid dealing with his own capacity for violence and struggling with his own identity. And in order to bond the audience with him, I felt that I needed him to be in pretty much every scene in the movie. And I didn't think I was saying anything that hadn't been tried before, but it turns out I was, because I think what the struggle was to try and tell too many stories and end up with every storyline, because the book has great storylines. There's Peter and Valentine's storyline, there's Demosthenes and Locke, and that's a great storyline on its own, but not necessarily visual, because they're two kids blogging. Also, everybody blogs now, so I felt we had to focus on Ender's journey. It's Ender's Game. And that gave me a very clear through line, and I just went away and wrote. It wasn't easy. It took about a year and a half. I only found out much later that I think the struggle before was everybody trying to get a lot of story in and therefore not getting anyone's story told in quite as much detail as did justice to what is in the book.
Yeah, it's funny that it has come out at this time, because it actually feels quite current in terms of Ender's being manipulated by those in authority. He's not sure who he can trust. And, you know, with recent revelations about government spying on people,
that's a very good point.
That actually feels quite, you know, timely.
Well, I think you make a very good point. I think that the fact that here we are now experiencing many of the things that the book kind of predicted in 1984, you know, here we are where the desk pads that were predicted in 1984 very much are iPads. So we didn't really have to do a lot of updating in the sense that the book gave us what we needed. We are in a world where we have drone warfare, where war is more and more being fought by young people behind computers using weapons at a distance that feel like a computer game. And so that detachment from the battlefield, how is that affecting us psychologically, both as the people flying those drones and as viewers who watch war on CNN, you know, and see things. And there's music, and everybody turns it into a kind of manipulative piece of entertainment, which of course we do in the movie as well. I think what we do in the movie is we try to seduce the audience, much as Ender is being seduced by the cool propaganda, by the you will be a hero, join up, sign up, we need you. And then hopefully you pull the rug out from underneath. It's like, wait a minute, at what point do I take responsibility for what I feel about this, as opposed to trying to please adults or, you know, so I think those themes from the book are very topical right now. Yeah,
absolutely. And you were conscripted as a young person as well.
Yeah.
So did that give you an extra sort of just dimension on what Ender is feeling, what Ender's going through in the battle school?
Yeah, I think talking to various fans, different fans of the book, everybody thinks they come to this book from the same point of view, but we don't. We all have different life experience. And we connect with these characters based on different experiences. My experience as reading it as an adult was that I was drafted when I was 17, and I'm reading this book and going, wow, why is it resonant? Science fiction, the kid's younger than I was at 17, but these feelings that he has about being taken from home, placed far away, being praised for aspects of his personality that are more aggressive. There's a great scene in the movie that I love where he's playing the mind game. It's just a game. And he wins a moment in the game by doing something outside of the rules of the game and rather violent. And one of his classmates, Ali, is repulsed by what he did. And even though it's a game, he goes, why'd you do that? And Ender, slightly guiltily, but also with a degree of ego and pride at having won, says, well, that's what they want from us. Follow the rules, you lose. Choose violence, you win. That's what we do here. And that's a frightening line as a parent to hear coming from a young person for me. And deliberately so, because of course that's where Ender is at that moment in the story. He's got an ego. He wants to win, even though he resents authority. He's still in that twisted place of wanting to please authority. How about that? I won. How about that? He says. And then when he realizes, without giving it away, there's a certain self-loathing that kicks in, and so begins a real transformation from childhood to adulthood, when you start to take responsibility, regardless of what the influences outside of you are, and you stop blaming everything around you and start to say, well, to what extent am I culpable, and how will I choose to live my life? And there's no right choice per se. I don't want the film to look like it's telling people how to live. I love the fact that people argue about it. I just like the fact that we've got a big popcorn movie with lots of cool stuff and maybe a bit of a heart at the center that you can have a few discussions with across the generations. Yeah.